Fun. My name is Laura, and it's my pleasure to welcome you. I think we can start recording now for the colleagues who are recording. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the fourth session of the From 2.5 to Zero Digital Roadshow series. We're focusing today on the creative response. So what role does arts, community, and education play when it comes to shaping a societal response, but also policy change and action against air pollution in Thailand and beyond. So thanks for joining us. I'll be co-hosting with my co-moderator, and we'll get into that in a minute. But first of all, I just wanted to say a big welcome and remind everybody that we do have this simultaneous interpreter on the line. And make sure that you go to the bottom of the screen and select either English or Japanese, which is the proxy for Thai in this case. So thank you, Pura. Great. So today I'm Laura. I work at UNDP during the day and also with the Circular Design Lab. And I'm happy to be here. I don't know, is Kun Green on the line now? Or not quite yet? We're having a little bit of a delayed start due to the pouring rain and getting everybody on the line. But I just wanted to highlight that we are, or jump right in into what we're doing and why we're here. And then we'll go back and give more introductions. But first, we are a group of volunteers, the Circular Design Lab and the Thailand Clean Air Network. And we've joined up to put together this From 2.5 to Zero Right to Clean Air Digital Roadshow. This is all centered around the fact that air pollution has been increasingly getting worse in Thailand over the last few years. And there's not a, while there may be some community response and awareness is certainly growing, there's not a true legal protection for people's right to clean, breathe clean air, and you know, people in Thailand are exposed to pollutants at a rate that exceeds a lot of other parts of the world. So we decided to work with the Thailand Clean Air Network and their support their work to launch a citizen-driven process of developing a Clean Air Act in Thailand. And that process looks like, in that process, Thaicán has put together a huge body of research in the form of a blue paper that is now out in the world on our website here. And it really goes into the details of what is happening in Thailand. You know, what are the causes of air pollution that we're seeing? And what are the gaps in data and knowledge about what's happening? And then also what are the potential solutions? And those are also detailed, those will be further detailed as the citizen-driven process towards this this legislation moves forward. But the blue paper itself is quite a lengthy document. So in order to support that process, the Circular Design Lab has teamed up with Thaicán to, you know, take that to put it into sort of bite-sized pieces for everyone to understand what's happening and what we can do about it. And not only on the science and policy side, but also from a broader perspective. So that's where we're getting today. You know, what are artists, what are community members, what are entrepreneurs, what are innovators doing as well, you know, to come to across the system of this air pollution response. So we're really excited to have today the arts and community perspective, as well as a student team with us. To bring a different perspective to the science and policy process. I just want to direct everybody to our website. Here you can follow along with what we're doing and also take action and find out more about how to support the policy process, which I'll get into at the end. But I want to also highlight the fact that this is not only online, and tonight We actually have a corresponding event. It's a bit more open beyond the air pollution side of things, but we are getting together in person right after this webinar at the Cafe Na in Bangkok 1899 here in the old town of Bangkok. And we'll hopefully see some of you there to have a zero waste meet and greet. So stay tuned on our website. Again, you can find out about all of these upcoming events and things that opportunities to contribute. Glad to have you here. So just want to do a check and see if my co-moderator, Quinn Green, is on the line. Okay. Well, he will join us shortly, I'm sure. Very excited to have Quinn Green, who is himself a singer and really excited to participate in this process. Great. Without further ado, I want to hand it over to our panel of which is what we're really here to hear from. So we have with us today Christopher Moore, who is the founder of the Changing Climate, Changing Lives Film Festival, which will be held in November. And we'll hear from Kun Tawisak Mosawat, who is an artivist, artist and activist. He can tell you more about that. And then also the student team Strawberries, or will tell you about their product that they have designed called Strawcohol that is approaching the air pollution challenge from the ground up. And they are also the recent winners of a Youth for SDGs award that was held by the UNDP Thailand office. So Christopher, I would like to hand it to you to tell us about the Changing Climate, Changing Lives Film Festival.
Thank you very much, Laura. And thank you and Courtney as well for the excellent process that you put us all through for this to happen. It's much appreciated. Let me give you a little bit of a background here. The CCL 2020 Film Festival was born of really kind of a simple idea. The idea was to bring attention and awareness to climate change impact issues in Thailand. Now, one of the things I discovered kind of early on, thinking about how best to do this, was examining the Thai language. You probably know that there is no Thai phrase for climate change. And until you have a word for an object or for an event, it's very difficult to process what that is. In fact, I think there is a separate contest now being conducted in Thailand to try to come up with a phrase for climate change. So part of the problem that we've had with climate change is being able to communicate what it is. And until you have word that actually is like climate change resonates with all of the various parts, from air pollution to loss of biodiversity, melting glaciers, coral reef damage, and there are many other examples, from flooding to extreme weather. And a number of these events are already being experienced in Thailand. So I thought last year, one way perhaps to make a difference in this debate would be to elicit where the strengths are in the Thai community, and that's really in the visual arts, in design, in video. Thais excel. They have the kind of talent and creativity that's the envy of many other places. So to engage that visual art impulse in Thai culture was one idea. And the other is to engage youth. Youth now have platform through the internet to create a degree of connectivity that's never been here before. People are connected, they can communicate in a particular way. So the idea of the film festival is use the visual arts to connect people with the environment, to show what the impact is, And rather than going doom and gloom, blame and shame, to go the route of where are the positive stories, where are the positive projects at a community level that can be visualized to show how people are innovating in a creative way at the village, regional level in order to combat the worst impacts that are occurring in their communities. Every student out there has, or most of them have, cell phones. With a cell phone, suddenly they have a camera. And with a camera, they have a way to visualize what's going on in their community. And what CCCL 2020 is seeking are short films, under 10 minutes, where a student will go out with their camera into the community, seeking examples of where local knowledge and ancient wisdom are being used to mitigate and to adapt to climate change. I think one of the important parts of this exercise is putting together larger communities. Like, for example, you're looking on the screen here, recording artists, Ajahn Chi on the far left there, and Chi and Hugo, one of Thailand's superstars, re-recorded a couple of weeks ago a ballad in the Karen language written and performed by Kun Chi about our relationship with nature. And one of the beautiful things about this song, which will become the theme song of our film festival, is about our connection with nature. And in many ways, what climate change teaches us is we've left the path. We've left the path a long time ago, perhaps 200 years ago, where we were part of nature. We were with nature. We read its signs. Its signs meant something to us. Now we're, most of us are living in cities. We go from one room to another. We live in a condo or a house. We go to schools, we go to cinemas, we go to all kinds of places, but they're always in a room. The light is artificial, they're air conditioned. We are disconnected with our natural resources. And as a result, we have left the path of our ancestors. And that path is thousands of years old. And what we're doing with this film festival is encouraging students to show us back to where we left, to try to reconstruct what we were doing before we became consumers, before we saw nature as a source of wealth, a source of wealth that could be exploited, and ultimately turned into waste. That's what consumerism is. We extract from nature, we turn it into a product, and the product becomes waste. And we've done that for enough time that we can see the impact already in terms of our quality of air, the quality of our water, the seas that we have, our agricultural land, all have had adverse impact. So we know these kinds of problems and we know what's happening. So the question is how can one person with a camera make a difference? They can make a difference by going out and finding what people are doing to cope, what they're doing to adapt, particularly in the agricultural lands. Thailand is still an agricultural country. Most people make their living attached to agriculture. We tend to forget that. Thailand is one of the top countries that is vulnerable to the extreme heat and to flooding and extreme weather. So there's no question that we have to adapt. The question is how to go about that. And the process of going about that shouldn't be some kind of abstract discussion. It should be visualization of what people are doing locally, because they're the ones who are actually experiencing these problems firsthand and are having to find creative ways to cope with what's going on. So I think the arts have always been transformative. They've taken the best of our human experiences and the worst of them, but they've given us a mirror. And we need to stare into that mirror at who we've become and at the path that we've taken. We need to find our compass and use that compass to go back to a pathway that will lead us to a more sustainable future. And CCCL 2020 is a contribution by many wonderful creative Thai people who are trying to make that difference, of trying to say, here is a compass, watch my film, here is one way back to the path, join us. And we hope that at the end of this, with the winning films, that we will take these films to international film festivals around the world to showcase the creative, artistic talents of the Thai people, to show that there are positive steps that can be taken at a community level, and those steps can be meaningful to the lives of people today and can help people in the future make certain that they are born into a world that is habitable. So I think we need to find a way to work together. We talked a little bit before we went live on air about the alignment of various communities in Thailand who share a common vision, that understand that if we don't act, if we don't have ways of adapting, if we don't have examples of mitigation, then we face a very uncertain future. We share a timeline. You and me, we're different ages, but we're alive at the same time. But we come from a past where those people shared a timeline as well. We've broken with them. Unless we can fix that path and get back to a sustainable way of living, there will not be a future for generations yet to be born. This film festival is an attempt to try and shine a light on that path for a future which will be sustainable. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Christopher. I love this reminder to you know, capture the local experience and what's already happening in these creative responses all over the world, really, and look forward to seeing some of the films in November. Can you remind us the dates of the film festival?
First of all, for those who are listening, the deadline for submissions is the 15th of October. If you have a film that's 2 to 10 minutes, please enter. Please go into your community, find stories that will touch the hearts of people, because if we're going to make a difference in this fight against climate change, the difference has to be one that touches us emotionally. Mm-hmm. The Thais have a very rich language and heart. There are 850 Jai phrases, I know, because I wrote the book. And we need to go back to that tradition, to that root of the heart, and make films from the heart about these communities, because that's where hope lies. So please submit your films by the 15th of October. The festival will have its premiere on the 20th, 21st, and 22nd of November at Thai PBS at the auditorium, and the award ceremony will be televised as well.
Great. Thanks. We're looking forward to it. I do want to go back a little bit to in the presentation to introduce my co-host, Khun Green, and have him introduce himself.
Yeah,
so over to you, Khun Green.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. Sorry for my little mistakes. I have a little trouble to join this webinar, but anyway, I'm here. So very nice to meet you all. It's my great honor to have a time with you guys today. And hello, Laura, as well.
Hello.
Okay.
All right, so thanks, Khun Green, and you'll be singing later, is that?
Yes, I will sing later when
okay.
the the meeting is done. I have a song to sing for you all.
Excellent. We're looking forward to it. So thanks very much. And we'll be going back and forth with some Q&A later on. Just a reminder, if you do have a question, please post it in the Q&A function on Zoom, and we'll get right to it. So thank you very much. Great. So moving from the film festival to the art on the ground, we would like to hear from Kuntawisak Mosoat on your work as an artivist. So over to you.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. And I'm sorry for my voice. It might be a little bit difficult to hear or to understand. I have a really dry throat. This is the result of my health due to the air pollution that had happened in the past couple of years, because I have been working on my performance outside outside the building, because I believe in working with a community, put my artwork in front of the audience in a real situation in order to make a difference. Because I don't believe that art has to be in the gallery or in the white cube. And before I get started though, I would like to thank Christopher. Christopher actually covered a lot of points why art is significant for another way of communication to people, because we already have a multiple ways of communication, but why we need art? You know, that's a basic question for me, why I still believe that art would make a difference in society. I would like to, first of all, I would like to introduce myself first. My name is Tawisak Munsuat. I am an activist. I just, you know, come up with the word myself, meaning that I am an artist whose work is focused on social, cultural, and environmental and political issue. My work has started from design object to art object, and now I focus on a performance in order to make a communication effectively with others. And my work shifted from making an object to a social participatory art project, instead of, you know, I sit in my studio and thinking about things and then make a representation of the subject matter. But now I put the subject matter in front of the community, the younger generation, and hope that, you know, this process of being a part of the art project will sink in, and they will realize that, well, they have a power to make a change in whatever issue that they are interested in. Because I believe that art communicates through visual and non-visual means. The subject matter of art originated from culture and society. For me, art therefore is an instrument to critically and creatively analyze, engage, and cultivate for a new and diverse cultural and social value, including the environmental sustainability. Regarding my practice of clean air or air pollution, it started off a couple years back when I was participate in Bangkok Art Biennale in 2018 as a part of Marina Institute, Performance Institute. My plan to do a performance is that, well, I don't want to perform in BACC in my art space, because I want to bridge the gap between the ordinary people in society and the art atmosphere. So my proposal for the organizer is that, well, I want to do a performance starting from my house, located like, you know, 7 hours from my house to BACC, and I walk every day for 22 days from my house, you know, 7 hours at least. And then I perform at the BACC for another 4 hours. And I just realized that what I did is not only do an art project, but actually investigate what had happened in the environment and urban setting of Bangkok. You know, the second day of walking, the third day, what happened is that I hardly breathe because of the air pollution, the dust and everything, the construction site, and also the new train building, you know. So that's why the third day I have to wear a respirator in order to walk from my house to BACC. And that when it started, and now my health is affected from, you know, the air pollution as well. So I have to taking care of myself every day. That's why for me, the problem with air pollution has become a goal that if I can be a part of it, I would jump right into it. Not only that experience, but I also believe as an educator, I have been teaching for more than 20 years, but now I quit a full-time teaching job because I still love teaching, but I don't think that, you know, learning and practicing in studio only is would give the real impact. I'm not interested in creating the awareness anymore. I'm not interested in giving the information because we have ton of information. We a lot of information regarding pollution, air pollution, trash or whatever. How many cotton bags do we have to make in order to understand about the problem with plastic trashes? We don't need any more of the, you know, fabric bag, tote bag or whatever. We have to understand and act right now, making a change. That's why for me, you know, when I was teaching, I actually focusing on a certain class. My strategy is that, well, I will not teach you inside the classroom. You will be my student. You will be an active teacher, participants, I'm sorry. You will be a teacher, participant, and the organizer. You run everything. I will be, you know, the one who support you in whatever you want. So basically, we started off like, you know, we went to Chang Island, which is a very popular tourist destination, but it's a lot of problems there. You know, trashes, the environment, the flooding and everything. So we work with the younger generation in a local primary school. And the result is fantastic because now, you know, they understand it's their house. It's not my house. It's their house that they have to love it. And they have to be able to voice that right. If the tourists come to their house and trash their house or their environment, that's what they have to do. They have to be the one who protect the environment and their own house. It's not me. You know, I can come in, I can make an art performance and nothing happen after that. What's the point to do that? That's why for me, the social participatory art project is very significant. And I also had the opportunity to get the residency program with, I have to mention, to thank you them, the Peninsula Hotel Bangkok. You know, my project is different from other artists. I investigate, I do my research around the area that's close to Icon Siam. There's a lot of problems over there with the real community, with the unfortunate local primary school, you know. So I decided I want to work a project regarding the environmental issue with a student. And it's really amazed me that, well, the education in Thailand is actually changed a lot. They take all the handicraft classes or, you know, the art classes away and replace it with something else. Not all the students interested in science. We have to build and nurture students upon their interest. And it amazes me too, because a lot of them, you know, want to be something that 30 years ago, I have not imagined that will be a career. And it's very interesting because, you know, they want to make a difference, but whether or not the system allow them or nurture them or support them to be the different maker, because now I believe that the artist is the cultural and social instigator. You know, we really have to make a change. It doesn't mean that the artist make a beautiful object is not an artist, but I think that now more than never, we really need artists who focus on the social and environmental issue. But again, we have to work together, like Christopher say, you know, artists, art community, and real community, education. How would we construct the curriculum in order to allow or to let the student to be a part of the change in society, and also financial support? You know, for me, I'm lucky enough that I am also the independent researcher, and I also have my other income. But many of the artists, particularly young artists, if they want to jump into social and political, including environmental issue, it's very difficult to make a living. Like my performance, how would I sell my work? You know, plus, if you're nobody, just get out from school, how would you be a part of it and be able to make a living and continue practicing, you know, the social and environmental issue? It's very difficult. So I think that the financial support is very significant, not only for the artists, but also for the community. You know, if the community cannot put the food on the table, if we try to talk about the air pollution, nobody care, seriously, because they have no food to eat. How would we not only use art as a way to communicate, but at the same time, let them understand that by making a change, they will be able to make the better living, not only in terms of the income, but also quality of living. That has to happen. Institution, government, corporation, every part of this society have to work together. Otherwise, it won't work. You know, in the slide that all of you see is the most recent workshop that I have been working with the younger artists and also students from mostly from King Mongkut Institute of Technology, Lat Krabang. We do a really short and quick workshop for 3 hours, and then they perform regarding about, you know, air pollution, the title of this workshop, and also performance is breathing breath. It's really amazing how powerful and how diverse each of students who perform and participate and communicate in a different aspect. When they talk to me what they want to do, it's not only talking about the problems, but they actually analyze it. What is the cause of it? What's the problems? What should be done? And they actually work together. We need a younger generation to be a driver force, not for us, but for all of us. And that's what I want to, you know, leave it for now. Thank you.
Watch, Mr. Tuisa, I really appreciate about your speech, but I have some little question to ask you. That as a teacher, how could you, do you have your tips to communicate with your students, with the people around you, and how could you persuade them to realize that this problems is really a big thing? Do you have your own tips to communicate with them?
Well, actually, as I mentioned earlier, everybody know it, and most of them likely to want to make a change. But it's the way you have to construct the curriculum that allow them to be a part of it. And you know, you need to make sure that it will not be more academic learning experience. It's supposed to be fun. But at the same time, they have to aware of what had happened. It's very interesting, you know, if you allow them to be a teacher, to work with community. There's a lot of results that I, as a professor for more than, you know, 20 years, still amazes how they come up with a certain things, a certain points, or a certain issues that working with the younger generation. Because they talk the same language at the same time. Mm-hmm. I'm old. You know, a lot of things I don't know, but they know, they can communicate. That's why we have to make sure that it is my job to somehow to draw them, draw their interest. Students want to go outside. Students want to go in the community and work with other people because they want to show their interest. They want to show that they have a certain responsibility for, you know, things happen around them. Take a look at the recent events, political events, the younger generation come out. A lot of them, because they want to see some change, not only political issue, but also environmental issue. And I also incorporate movies, as Christopher say, you know, I incorporate a lot of movies that talking about environment. I'm talking about, incorporate some artists interested in social and environmental issues that, you know, they know and they want to connect with them and somehow one way or another. And that's my tip about getting them exciting with my class.
Thank you very much for your tips. Okay, so I think we have a great comment. Also, if anyone has a question, you can please ask the question in the box. Okay, so we are going to move to the students, right, Laura?
Yeah, that's right. So we're moving from the discussion of, you know, the teaching environment and how to inspire students and students working with communities to real life examples. So we're really pleased to have Khan and LK and Mamo. I may not have gotten your names right, but I'll hear from Team Strawberries, who have recently won the Youth for SDG Award in the air pollution category, put on by the UNDP Thailand country office. So I'd love to turn it over to the team to give us a look at their idea for a solution and what they're doing. So over to you, and I'll go right into your slides. You tell me when you want to change the slide.
Okay, good evening, everyone. We are Team Strawberries, and we are current juniors from International Community School. My name is Memo, and my teammates are Khan, LK, and Chogun. Unfortunately, Chogun can't attend the event today, but we'll continue on with our presentation as normal. Our product name, as you all might already might see, is Strawcohol, and it comes from straw, which is being turned into ethanol alcohol, which will be a useful product during this global pandemic. And we are a team that strives to improve the quality of the air, and we hope that our method and product will be able to decrease the amount of air pollution starting in Thailand. Next slide, please. So I think most of us are familiar with the fact that rice is a major economic crop of Thailand, and there's a lot of harvest waste from rice, which are rice straws. The problem is farmers decide to burn the rice harvest waste, and because this method is viewed as a cheap and effective way of getting rid of waste, you might say. And moreover, rice straws are unprofitable, which gives the farmers no incentive whatsoever to sell those straws. The consequences of these actions lead to the emission of greenhouse gases, which intensifies the ongoing problem of global warming. Next slide, please.
To address these problems, we came up with a solution that would provide the farmers an alternative to burning the rice harvest waste. That is, converting the rice harvest waste into ethanol alcohol using genetically modified yeast. Ethanol alcohol is a key ingredient in making the alcohol hand sanitizers we're using today, especially during the ongoing pandemic. Hand sanitizers are essential for those who want to keep themselves healthy. Next slide, please.
Our product, Strawcohol, consists of a bottle of hand sanitizing gel carefully packaged in a box made out of biodegradable plastic. The box will be stuffed with strips of rice straw to fit in with the team as well. All in all, it's a cheap-looking product that takes care of the environment and provides income for a large group of people while also being environmentally friendly. Next slide, please. But what sets us apart? Well, by genetically modifying yeast, we would be able to naturally break down rice straw into ethanol without requiring any other processes. This is extremely important when it comes to the financial aspect of things. We also offer the farmers a higher price for their harvest base than the market price, which would increase their income. We are essentially turning waste into a useful product that has various applications and addresses the global problem of air pollution as well. Next slide, please.
Our solution will lower the amount of crop field burning on a national scale as well. This will in turn significantly improve the air quality and lower the chances of forest fires. In the future, we could potentially use the ethanol made from the rice harvest waste as a main component to produce gas alcohol to compete in the automotive industry as well. Next slide, please.
Yeah, and that's it for our presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's great. I think just before we go to a broader Q&A and discussion, I'd love to hear a little bit more about how you, your process of getting to Strakahal. So how, we've talked a lot about Christopher and Hawisak. They both were talking a lot about, listening to the community and finding local solutions. And so this is such a great example of that. And I wonder how you came to Strakahal, if you can talk a little bit about that.
So during this competition, we looked into the problems that are causing air pollution in Thailand first. And we found out that burning harvest waste is a major problem. So we decided to research some methods where we can rid of this waste without causing more air pollution, which is currently they're burning it, right? So there's greenhouse gases. So we found this research which could genetically modify yeast to break down the rice straws without having any other procedures. But it's kind of we have to find the researchers for the genetically modified yeast. And so after we researched more deeply about that topic, we think that it would be a great idea to give the farmers more income since it's a really major work field, agriculture in Thailand. And by giving them more income, we will also decrease the amount of air pollution in Thailand as well.
Yeah, great.
Okay, go Laura.
No, I just see a question from Tito as to whether the straw after the composting or after the yeast has done its work can be composted into something that also has use to farmers.
Can you please repeat the question again?
Yeah, so I'm not very clear on the process, so forgive me, but if the straw that you're talking about after the yeast has, does it completely decompose the straw, or is there any sort of byproduct that can also be utilized in a productive way, like compost?
Okay, so normally yeast can decompose cellulose, mm-hmm. which is a major component of the straw. But by genetically modifying them, they would be able to decompose xylose as well, which is another part of the straw. So if we genetically modify them, they would be able to decompose the whole straw without having other byproduct except for ethanol alcohol.
Yeah, okay.
Wow, interesting. To be honest, this is very new to me. Yeah. Like the idea and project you to do. Okay, so any question? If the audience have the question, you can leave your question in the inbox, okay?
And I have a question?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Okay, I think it's a fantastic, you know, invention that you guys have made. However, I have a question though, what's next? Because, you know, normally what we do is we do a research, we, you know, develop a certain things, and then how we actually apply it to be used, whether or not, you know, by the local people, is more like a co-op, so that they will be able to start from the beginning until the end. They can be able to, they can use within the community or sell it if they have more, or, you know, somehow sell it to some corporation or whatever. But I like to hear your idea of, you know, how, what is next for your project.
Okay, so for what is next, first of all, about the how we are going to make the farmers generate more income, we're going to buy the straws directly from the farmers, so that cuts out the middleman and giving the farmers the benefit that they want. And because of this, we will have to modify create our product at our company. Like, we would have to manufacture ourselves, because I think that it would be a bit difficult for the farmers to do at this stage. But for right now, the problem is the genetically modified yeast. We haven't came up with it yet. Even though there's research that has been done into it, we would have to do continue further research into developing the genetically modified yeast. And if we are able to do that, then we can implement it in real life and then potentially create the product that we hope to make.
This is the point that I'm talking about. You know, we need a financial support for whatever project. Otherwise, it's become just the project.
Yeah. Yeah, how to make it go to market and become widespread.
I'd like to offer just an encouragement. It was a very good presentation. For you to do a short film for the competition for CCL 2020, because these are exactly the kind of projects that we would love to have other people be aware of. And to be part of a film festival will increase the reach of people who know what you're doing. Now, I mean, one of the things that the Ajahn raised, which I think is a very important one, in most projects, they may have benefit for an individual or a family or for a village. The question is always, do they scale? And what is the cost of scaling something? Because often you'll have a very good idea, but the question is okay, it works at this level, but if we scale it up, what are the kind of costs that we face at a scaled rate that we don't face when we look at just a village or community basis?
Thanks, Christopher. I'd like to go back to you for a moment, but first I want to just point out to Team Strawberries that there's so many opportunities here emerging, and that in the Q&A there's another one that Quintana Porn has invited you all to share your story in the United Nations Global Compact Thailand team. So there's some connections to follow up on, but again, to Kuntawisak's point about resources, you know, that's one of our hopes for this roadshow, is really to help connect all the dots and between different stakeholders and keep building this community around the air pollution discourse and challenge in Thailand, and help these solutions find a way to market or a way to an audience. And we look forward to seeing that grow. So very glad to see the connections coming through already on the line. I want to move to Christopher and just see along those lines, you know, this is really impressive, your body of work in Thailand, and as well as, you know, what you've been setting up to move forward with the film festival. But this is the inaugural year, as I understand, and so where do you see it going in the future, and how, you know, what does success look like in terms of what do you hope this film festival will set in motion for the future? You talked a little bit about that, but now having heard the other presenters, maybe you can comment on where this is going.
Thank you. It's a very good question, and it's one that I've thought about, as well as the advisory board of the festival, and our product manager, Kun Simona, has been very active. In terms of going forward for 2021, we've been very grateful to the Sang Foundation, Kun Matsuma, of that foundation for giving us a place to be able to do what we're doing. We'll probably be setting up our own foundation or a social enterprise company for 2021. What we plan to do is to take our festival products, which are the various films, into workshops, into schools, and hopefully have some of the winners of these young people to go along for presentations to inspire local students at the school level and the university level to really engage the youth movement. These are the people who understand very deeply what's happening, because it's their future which is in jeopardy. Those of us who are older will not see the worst impacts that are coming. It's the young people that need the support. And so the part of that support for 2021 will be school and university workshops, talks, seminars. We'll be going to film festivals across the world, and we're going to be working with other groups in other countries to use what we've done in Thailand as a blueprint, whether it's Cambodia or Vietnam, or whether it's somewhere in Europe or Africa or Latin America, because we feel that what we're doing is something that can be used by others for the benefit of their community.
Okay, yeah, thanks. It's great to see this build, and again, hope that that can become something that is a powerful communication tool. I think one thing that is coming up for me is that, you know, video, especially now, is such a shareable and often translatable medium to be able to have a reach well beyond the actual event itself. So that's something that is exciting about what you all are building. Kun Green?
Yes,
sure. Yeah, over to you.
Okay, we are have a few questions from Ajahn Noy, which is my professor since last 10 years. She asked that how to marry art with an environment law, how to combine it together, because Ajahn Noy is working on it. So could any, I may ask Kun Thawisak, in your perception, that could it be possible to combine it together about art?
Well, okay, for me, it's depend, you know. First of all, if it's become law already, it's the duty of the citizen, you know, have to obey the law. However, if to use art or, you know, mix art with the law to provide the information or encourage them, because I think that art can communicate deeper than the text and the verbal and written communication. So, for example, art that working with community would be a really good start to work with a community to really understand the law, you know, what is the law mean for them in order to minimize the effect to the environment. However, as I mentioned earlier, it's depend on the community and also the artist and other parties to be able to support. If I, you know, it's come down to making a living or put food on the table, if the local community cannot put food on the table, it doesn't matter how many laws do you have. they will break the laws for survival. That's become, you know, the venue for art to get in, to be able to work with the community used art approach to communicate in a deeper level. It's not just only law, but face to face, you know, human to human, cause and effect is right in front of you. But how would you communicate that? Not only for the older generation, but the younger generation in particular. Art can help a lot because, you know, in a way, art making, art thinking is very meditative. They enjoy working with the hand and understand the mind and the analytical thought process that come with the creating the art object or art concept. Because I don't believe that art object would say everything that we want it to say. Sometimes say without saying is deeper than, you know, making an object. So basically I think the experience is much more important than the physical object. The physical object that the community art project that Mike created to me is a reminder of an experience. The experience is certainly significant in order to address the issue about law and what they can do and what they can do, and the effect it is the effect from the action that they decided to do, that can communicate through experience of art community project.
Could I just make a comment here? I was a law professor for 10 years in Canada and in England. So I have a bit of a background in law, and I think it's a very interesting question, the intersection, the junction where art and law meet, is that from my perspective as a lawyer and former law professor, is that the framework of legal systems don't just come out of thin air. They come out of a culture, they come out of an environment, they come out of a set of expectations that are driven by economics, driven by social concerns, by religious beliefs, a lot of different factors. So the framework of law is, in a sense, there to guard and protect, in a way, what is destroying the planet. A lot of the corporate interests, a lot of the things that we take as law-oriented are put in place to protect the kind of interests that are not necessarily supportive of the kind of changes that need to be made. So what needs to be done, and from my point of view, is to engage the legal community through the arts to show that there need to be a different kind of framework, there needs to be adjustments. And unless those adjustments are made, we'll have a legal framework for an economic system that no longer works. And ultimately, unless we make those changes, that's what will happen in 30 to 50 years.
Okay, thank you. This is really interesting. May I go back to Kun Tawisak and then, what's your view on that, or how can we communicate such concept without the vocabulary in Thailand? I got this from Laura. Yes, right?
I can jump in. I think we, if it's okay, but we heard from Christopher about the fact that, you know, climate change doesn't really have a, there's not the vocabulary in Thai language. And for Kun Tawisak, I wonder, you know, you're communicating these really intangible, if you will, concepts through art. But what is your view as a Thai artist about how we can communicate concepts like air pollution, these broad, you know, global concepts at the sort of personal scale, when perhaps we don't have the right words to speak about them?
Well, I think the translation or the Thai word for the greenhouse effect or things like that. I don't think that, I mean, it would be nice if we have, but it's not the most significant to make the awareness or understand the problems of global issue in terms of the environment. Because, yeah, you know, we all use English in a way to talking about the things that have been changed and all the problems that had happened in the past. So that's one of the question. But for me, I still have no word for that myself. Because normally what we do, we use the English language as a way to communicate, and most of the student or even like student in the primary school still understand it. They even know, you know, how, what is a 4R for prevent the environment, you know? So things like that, they actually talk in English and explain in Thai. So basically, I believe that this kind of word has become a household words now. They know what it meant, but we may not have the translation in Thai, but sometimes, you know, some word that are very easy to communicate in English, but once the government try to translate it, it doesn't make any sense in Thai. And for Thai people, and that's so funny for me. Well, you know, so that's my take on the word itself. So
yeah, but I think as seen through the work, especially that you're doing, you can really feel air pollution in your body, and that there's no need for words to describe it if you can. I remember reading about this very successful exhibit called The Pollution Pods that Michael Pinsky, an artist in the UK, put on, where you walk through these pods, you know, to experience what the air quality is like in different parts of the world. And I can imagine that would be a really effective also communication tool about, you know, if you can just feel this in your body.
Yeah, that you're right, Laura, because, you know, every day I wake up in the morning, during the day, I experience this every day. That's why on my Facebook, I post almost every day talking about the air quality in Thailand and different parts of Thailand. Because, you know, you face it every day. You get out of your house. There's a lot of problem with the environment. And because we face it every day. So that's become a force for us and for the younger generation to actually really want to make a change. Otherwise, we will have to live with it. And it's not good for your health. It's not good for your children. And yeah, it's not good for anyone. You know, for me, the language itself is not a big barrier in terms of communication regarding the problem. And they know that it's not about Thailand either. This kind of problem is moved across the physical boundary of the countries. It's become a global issue. So the yeah, question is that how would we work together? Not only locally, but we have to start locally. That's why for me as an artist and as an educator, I'm focused on the younger generation. We have to start from our house, to our local community, to the country, and to the world. If you cannot take care yourself, your house, how would you be able to take care the world? And that's how it should be working.
Green, you're muted.
Oh, sorry. As I said, I'm very new to the Zoom. Okay,
I have one quick question, if that's okay, Green.
I think we're going to get to that one right now, sure. Actually. But okay. If you want to jump in and phrase it, that's great. Please go ahead.
Okay. This is something that was asked of me the other day. Apparently, the UN runs annual surveys about what the youth consider to be important factors in life. And one of the issues that they ask about is, how does the environment affect you? And apparently the survey results have turned out that youth, particularly in Thailand, relative to every other Southeast Asian country, considers environment very lowly in terms of its importance in terms of what they focus on. So I'd just be interested to hear what Team Strawberry thinks about this, and also Kunta Wisak and Christopher as well, because you also work quite closely with the youth. Thank you.
Yeah, Team Strawberries, if you want to jump in here, that would be great. We'd love to hear from you.
About the survey, for me personally, I think the environment means a lot to me because I really like outdoor activities. I like playing sports also, so it's like a big part of my life. And I think that how the environment is really affects our mood in a day, which can affect our education, and which is a big factor of life as well as a high school student. So yeah, I'll just say that environment really affects me, and I think that it's really important that we start taking care of it right now, because if we wait like for the next generation or after that, it might be too late to save our environment.
Do you see any difference in how you and your classmates and your friends perceive the environment and other generations that you interact with?
I think nowadays the topic that is a hot topic that most students talk about is not about environment. It's more about like the materialistic side of the world and not about the nature anymore. And I think that it's really important that we bring up this topic in our daily life, not just to be aware of it, but to start taking action and make sure that people are actually like passionate about this topic. Yeah.
Thanks.
You know, I think part of the discussion on the environment, again, I think it's partly a inequality of wealth and circumstances. People who are wealthy, who live in aircon circumstances, don't experience extreme weather, for example. If it's 43 degrees somewhere in Isan, no matter if you're in your aircon car or your aircon office or home, you don't have that experience. And so by isolating ourselves from nature, the environment becomes less relevant to the actual living of our lives. Now, if you're walking like some of us do outside, you do understand that when you live in a city and you breathe that air, you're breathing in something that is not healthy. And that's why you don't see a lot of people walking or bicycling for that particular reason. It's an avoidance mechanism. So we have technology and we have ways of living that allows us to go into a state of denial or avoidance of what's happening to the environment. And until we address that, we're just going to slide further down that hill.
Wow. Okay, so
well, for me, you know, when we're speaking about the younger generation or the youth, I don't want to say that, well, we live everything, you know, with the youth, because what had happened now is our generation and the generation before us, we have to be the one to really initiate and push it further. But again, the youth is the one who have a lot of energy and the knowledge of the new technology, new approach, because that's they're gonna be in whatever they build upon for the future. But for me, for the adult, I may have just some year left. So, you know, not to say that to live it with them, but we have to work on it. And to work on it, we cannot separate. We're talking about the issue of environmental, but we're not talking about the issue of a social and cultural and economic issue. We cannot separate those many different things. We have to work together and make sure that it's actually interwoven, and make sure that they understand by changing, by adapting, the result will be not only good for the health or, you know, the children, but at the same time, the income could be better too. Instead of like me, you know, I start off as an industrial designer, but I never thought that I would do industrial design because I don't believe in that. I rather make a few objects and happy with it and have less impact on the environment. If I make 1,000 pieces and make a profit, a baht, I make 10 pieces, I profit a baht, plus sharing my profits with community, why don't I pick the second one? Why we have to, you know, do or practice the same way that we practice? We have no need for that. Because the experience I had in my real life, I went to study in the state. And, you know, I absorb, and the way of living over there actually have influence on my way of living at this, at that time. You know, my watch, I don't know what you call it. It's just actually the leather part is broke. And I thought, well, I just buy a new one, go to Walmart, it's cheap. You know, I don't have to spend time do anything, fast and cheap. And then I realized if I were in Thailand, I will fix it myself. And I'm an artist. I can make it my watch instead of industrial watch. So I started to sew it into a certain pattern. And it's beautiful. Every time I wear it, all my friends ask me, where did you get this? Hey, I just fix it myself. By fixing it, appreciate the handmade of it, we don't have to produce more. And that's how I take it.
We agree with you. As Ajahn Noy and Kunbina said that, social, cultural, political, and economic dimensions cannot be separated. Yes. Okay, so one last thing, I think right now we come to the last sessions of today's webinar. So could the panelists can leave the, you know, like one last word for the audience, please. We'll begin with Mr. Christopher, please.
Yes, I'm very pleased to be able to participate today because I think what we're all interested in is helping to nurture a future of role models in Thailand. We need a new set of role models from the youth up. Those are the people who will be the guides to where we're going. That is part of what we're doing with CCL 2020 Film Festival. We are talent scouting the people with a vision who can share that vision and be role models. We need to get away from the old system of role models with glitzy celebrities with fancy cars and houses and yachts. That is not what we should be emulating or admiring. We need to bring up a new generation that will value people in a way that matters for what we face. And what we face is a future of climate change.
Well, okay. For me, art cannot make a difference if a different parties in society cannot be a part of this change. You know, starting from yourself, you will amaze that, you know, people around you will notice how much you change. And then they will adopt or adapt from what you have changed. Believe me.
Okay, so start from yourself. Okay, so go for the students, memory, okay.
Could you please? First of all, I would like to thank you for this opportunity, and I would like to encourage all the youths and students all around in Thailand to start fighting for like this change in climate so that we can make the environment better for all of us. And I want them to be as passionate as fighting for like political rights. I want them to be as passionate as that, as fighting for a change, a better change in our environment as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, LK or Khan, do you also have a final word that you'd like to share?
Final word
from the rest of the team, yeah.
Okay. Well,
yeah, so I also agree with Memo in that I think that like the youth are the future, and so like I would encourage all of the younger generation to like start looking into the issue and like trying to contribute as much as possible in solving this big problem regarding to air pollution, as in a short run it may not have like an immediate harm, but in the long term yeah, it could like impact our lives to like a very high degree. Yeah.
Okay,
as for me, I think that it's really important that we all have to work together regardless of who we are, where we're from, how old we are, our background, all of that. It all matters because it's a team effort. Like one person cannot stop the air pollution by themselves. It's just impossible. It has to be a lot of people who work together, and especially youth and people who are educated in this field. We should all be working together into creating a better future for ourselves.
Thanks so much. It's been really inspiring to hear from all of you about the, you know, local solutions that are being highlighted, as well as the, you know, the need to connect with communities and the work that you're all doing to connect with a wide variety of people through the arts. I know personally I'm really inspired by this session and really look forward to looking into some of these things more and attending the film festival that's coming up. So as we move forward with this work, I just want to, you know, stay tuned, stay on the line. We still have our final performance coming from Coon Green, so that's coming up. But first, I want to let you know of a few things that are coming up and that are, you know, remind you of what's available and what's really happening in the sidelines of this roadshow. So again, if you go to our website, righttocleanair.com, or the Thailand Clean Air Network's website, which is here, you can learn more about the actual legislation that has been presented to Parliament and is under discussion now. And then the TICAN is in the process of gathering signatures from Thai citizens for support to that process. And we started this, or they started this a couple of weeks ago at the BACC in person, but it can continue not in person. You can send in a signature if you would like, and there's more information about the Draft Clean Air Act, as well as this process of taking action on their website. And for non-Thai citizens, you can sign on to a petition that's going on change.org, which is also linked through our website as pictured here. So really, you know, we're trying to, with this roadshow, connect the dots between the policy and the science, but also between the community and awareness and action. And this is really the main way that, you know, you can take action today if you're interested and passionate in these issues. And I also want to highlight that for students, another opportunity that's emerged is that the RSA, the Royal Society of Arts in the UK, has an annual design competition, and every year there are different themes. This is open for university students, I believe, as well as graduate students. So it may not be a possibility for Team Strakahal right now, but perhaps through friends or other future opportunities. But anyway, the circular design. Design Lab this year has teamed as the World Resources for the competition, and this is open right now. You can go to sda.rsa.org and find out more about this opportunity. And then next we have in October, we'll be looking at the gaps that remain in terms of what kinds of data is still needed in Thailand to understand air pollution more fully, what kinds of research and other gaps are needed. And we've heard about some of them today in terms of gaps in funding and support for this work. And then we'll also be putting on a systemic design workshop, which will help everybody who's interested in this community really take a deep dive and learn some of the tools of how to think about these big wicked problems like air pollution in a way that breaks it down into identifying levers for change in the system. So that's what's coming up. And all of these are free and open to anyone who wants to join. But without further ado, I'd really like to hand it over to my wonderful co-moderator, Kun Green, who's gonna close us out with a song. So I hand over to you, but thank you very much from the Circular Design Lab and the Thai Clean Air Network for coming and for joining us on this very insightful and provocative session about the creative response. So over to you, Kun Green.
Okay, thank you. So firstly, I have to confess that I'm very excited right now because this is my first time to have an online singing. So the song that I'm going to perform today is the song called Heal the World, which is, I really do believe that you all might know this song. It's the Michael Jackson's. And the reason I choose this song, it's, it appears on the name of the song, Heal the World, because we all know that we can make our world to be a better world, be a better place. So come on, I have a microphone with me now. So let's start. So if any one of you can sing, then you can sing with me. Go.
There's a place in your heart, and I know that it is love. And this place could be much brighter than tomorrow. And if you really try, you'll find there's no need to cry. In this place, you feel there's no hurt or sorrow. There are ways to get there if you care enough for the living. Make a better place, make a better place. Heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me. Do you want to know why there's a love that cannot lie? Love is strong, it only cares for joyful giving. If we try, we shall see. In this place we cannot feel. Fear or dread, these things are of living. Sinner feels that always love's enough for the growing. Make a better world, make a better world. Heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me.
Sadika!
Conceive a river of joyful faith. And the world we want to live will shine again in grace. And we changing life. Time is for soul. Though it's plain to see, it's with heavenly. Be God's glow. Let our spirits never die. In my heart, I feel you are all my brothers. Create a world with no fear. Together we'll cry heaven tears. See the nations and taste our kingdom's trouble. We can really get there if you care enough for to leave it. Make a little space to make a better place.
The world,
make it a better place for you and for me, okay. So it's the song for you all. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.